type of problem that you may encounter may be different. But to start with, you will have to pinpoint the pathophysiology or the origin of the bleed. Whether the bleed is due to a platelet type of bleed, namely either due to decreased number of platelets or due to a platelet dysfunction. Second, whether it is due to the vascular fragility or is it a coagulation dysfunction or disorder. If you look at, summarize the clinical history, physical examination, that may give the clue to pinpoint the type of bleed. The platelet bleed is usually spontaneous, superficial, stops with pressure, and occurs usually in the superficial plane, namely in the skin and mucous membrane. This is the type of bleeding that you encounter when the bleeding is due to the platelet. On the other hand, a vascular bleed, the classical example would be a kinoxon in papillae in a child or a vasculitis in a female. Usually, it is symmetric, most often in the lower limb, and purple rash, hemorrhagic rash. You have a prodromal, a burning sensation or a pain raised above the surface, and you have other systemic symptoms. This is a type of vascular bleed where the platelet bleed is usually is not raised. You can't palpate a platelet bleed, but a vascular bleed, you can always palpate the hemorrhagic rash. This is one of the important difference. Symmetrical, tender, a prodromal burning or pain is present. Association with the other systemic features, most often a renal involvement would point towards a vascular bleed. On the other hand, if you encounter a coagulation disorder bleed, the classical example would be a hereditary disorder like hemophilia, an acquired disorder like a hepatic coagulopathy. The bleed occurs after a lag, means the trauma. And after a few hours, or even after a surgery, 1 or 2 days, you have a bleed. Most often, the bleeding is deep-seated, either in the joints, most often the knee joint, ankle joint, or the elbow joint, or the muscles. The most common muscle involved in the coagulation bleed, as you are aware, in hemophilia, is the iliopsoas muscle. Therefore, the coagulation bleed, on the other hand, deep-seated, comes after a lag after the trigger, and it won't be stopped by pressure. Unlike the platelet bleed, whatever amount of pressure you apply, a coagulation bleed cannot be stopped. I think fundamentally, a physician has to make a difference from the clinical history and the physical examination, whether you are dealing with a platelet type of bleed, or the bleed is due to a excessive vascular fragility, or an underlying coagulation factor deficiency, or an inhibitor is responsible for the bleed. With this introduction, I will go into the diagnostic problems that you may encounter when trying to diagnose the immune thrombocytopenic papilla. I'll start with a classical case. Please go. That is the thing. Right side. Yeah, this is a classical clinical scene. I see. A 41-year-old male patient reported to a dental college with a complaint of bleeding gums since 2 weeks. Patient was known to have an IHD for the past 7 years. Patient was on isosorbide, dinitrate 10 milligrams, tablet atenolol 25 milligram and NVAS 5 milligram. Patient had discontinued aspirin 6 months ago. And as you can see in this picture, patient was having purplish spots on body for the past 2 months. And he had developed petechial spots over the forearm and the right arm. And you see the gums, which are spongy, bleeding, and have a reddish tinge, and the tender on palpation. These are the laboratory reports that you got. LFT was normal, ultrasound, abdomen, did not reveal any hepatic splenomegaly. CBC done showed isolated severe thrombocytopenia. With this information, the clinical history, the gradual development of the bleed, mainly confined to the skin and the mucous membrane, no other underlying cause known. You know the features, namely fever and arthralgia or any other epigastric pain or any other features to indicate malignancy, loss of weight, lack of appetite. This sort of more or less orphaned clinical history and the physical examination showing you mucocutaneous bleed, more often a characteristic feature in ITP would be an ecchymosis above the anterior superior spine, a cutaneous ecchymotic patch, otherwise in an afebrile patient, or just above the anterior superior spine, this protective morning of an ITP, where the physical examination doesn't show any hepatosplenomegaly or any peripheral lymphadenopathy, isolated mucocutaneous bleed, especially oral cavity bleed, if that is going to be a severe thrombocytopenia and the platelet count is less than 10,000. If you want to define the ITP or the immune mediated acquired disease, can occur both in adults and children. The definition wise, the platelet count should be less than 1 lakh, although most often they come to the clinician when the platelet count is less than 40,000. Spontaneous bleed occurs in ITP once the platelet count is less than 40,000. If you look at the recent thinking in the pathogenesis of this ITP, we are all aware, is a disorder where the thrombocytopenia is caused due to excessive peripheral distraction of the platelet, immune mediated or antibody mediated. That's what we have learned in our yester years in our medical college. But the thinking has radically changed now. Yes, that does contribute, but equal contribution is by production problem. This antibody seem to attack the megakaryocytes in the marrow, resulting in an ineffective or a defective thrombopoiesis, contributing to the low platelet number on the clinical symptomatology. Yeah, the recent classification in anywhere nowadays, in order to improve our communication as well as improve the specificity in our clinical trials, definitions are required, and this is a definition for the different types of ITP or the immune thrombocytopenic purpura that you may encounter in clinical practice. Primary is one where the count is less than 1,000, you don't have any other underlying problem discernible. Second would be you have a primary disease which results in the low platelet count. The most common, SLE in a middle-aged female, an HCV infection, where you have a history of jaundice and features of liver problem, and you have a history of a drug-induced thrombocytopenia, where usually after an NSAID intake, sulfonamide, or in the acute care unit, after heparin treatment, or in the usual medical unit, after the anti-malarial, the classical prototype will be the quinine. chronic type induced thrombocytopenia. Japan, of course, the most common cause it appears with usually the features of gastritis is Helicobacter pylori infection. In our midst, it plays a minimal role. In any young male with a classical history of weight loss, with frequent attacks of fever, the possibility with thrombocytopenia, whenever you encounter in clinical practice, the profound weight loss in a young male with or even a middle-aged male with a history of exposure and you have got a thrombocytopenia, it is mandatory to exclude HIV infection. This is the primary and this is, you know, the underlying cause is secondary. You define newly diagnosed when the thrombocytopenia is less than 3 months. Persistent, when it is between 3 to 12. Chronic, when it is more than 12. Severe, when the symptoms are severe, warranting a need for treatment. Refractory, when you exhibit various treatments, but the results you are not achieving. This is the incidence, roughly, is given in textbook, and all of us know women could be more common 1.5 times, but in children, the boys and the girls, the incidence will be same. As you grow older, the incidence is supposed to be higher. Pediatric ITP is a different ballgame. By and large, you have a spontaneous mucopitaneous bleed after some trivial viral infection, which, by and large, may not need any specific treatment. Many a time, it resolves by itself, and around 90% of the time, by 6 months, the child will be free from the problem. If you encounter a pure, spontaneous mucocutaneous bleed in a child, possibilities like your post-viral thrombocytopenia, drug-induced thrombocytopenia, and ITP, it may be difficult to differentiate between these three entities. Very rare situations, I'll come to that little later, what we call as TTP, or a thrombocytopenic purpura, which is a classical penter. By and large, you have fever, a little bit of altered sensorium, mild renal dysfunction, and declining hemoglobin due to microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. The peripheral smear examination gives you the diagnosis of this rare TTP, which is difficult to treat in our day-to-day practice. This is the incidence. The female usually is more than the male. Clinical presentation, by and large, you encounter in adults the gradual manifestations of spontaneously appearing cutaneous bleed in the nature of petechiae, or you see the classical ecchymotic patch in the leg, or this is ominous, the web bleed in the oral cavity usually harass a retinal bleed and later an intracerebral bleed in a patient with ITP. Therefore, this patient would need treatment immediately. A subconjunctival bleed is very common. Referral from ophthalmologist to the hematologist for evaluation of the bleeding disorder. Most of the time, spontaneously disappear. But when it is accompanied by other bleeds, it may require treatment. The intracerebral bleed is the most ominous clinical problem in a patient with ITP, usually presents with severe headache, seizures, altered sensorium, demanding the urgent need for imaging, most often a CT scan or an MRI, giving you the diagnosis, warranting an immediate treatment, most often an IV immunoglobulin. If the patient is not affordable, are we lethal spreading so long? These are the symptoms you will be surprised that apart from the spontaneous mucocutaneous bleed, you can have epistaxis, meningitis in the female, and whenever you have a GI bleeding ITP, rule out a local pathology. But if you go deeper into the patient's symptomatology, very often the patient will complain of non-specific fatigue. I think I will rest through then. What you should understand, ITP is not only a bleeding disorder, it is also a hypercoagulable state. And 20 to 30% of the ITPs can have what we call aqua syndrome, which can present as a clotting disorder. This is the most important thing. These are all the various features, differentiation. Adult ITP is usually chronic, pediatric is usually spontaneously recover. I think mechanism, I told you both, not only destruction, it's a production problem also. The antibody can attack the megakaryocytes also. This is a mechanism where the antibody against the glycoprotein, mainly involving glycoprotein 2B and 3A. This is the thrombophyting, like erythropoietin for red cell precursor, is inappropriately low. Now the most of the treatment is centered around this concept, giving a thrombophyting mimetic. We use a drug called L-thrombopag or Revelar in an acute care setting. Diagnosis, I told you, a sheet ankle would be a peripheral sphere examination. And a mean, we exclude the other causes. ITP is a diagnosis of exclusion. Platelet count, by and large, is less than 1 lakh. These are some of the investigations we may like to perform. The most important thing would be the need for bone marrow should be considered when a patient is more than 60 years old, because the differential diagnosis will be a myelodysplastic syndrome. Or when a patient has a relapse of the breathing, or is not responding to the first line therapy, or when you are contemplating splenectomy. Now we are including the HIV, HCV, and H. pylori antibody investigation routine. In a child, intravenous immunoglobulin estimation may be crucial to exclude combined variable immunodeficiency. I think I'll stop here. If any questions are there, I'll address. I'm sorry, I couldn't go into the depth. There are various clinical presentations, both in a routine outpatient setting, in a usual medical ward, in a critical care unit, in a post-operative surgical situation, or in a cardiology unit, namely after the CABG, post-surgical bleed, or when you do the angioplasty, the thrombocytopenia occurring acutely, the treatment or the thrombocytopenia in a pregnant female is entirely a different situation, requiring different approaches. I'm sorry, I don't have time to go into the details of this each situation. Yes, sir.
I will ask a slightly different question on the topic.
Yeah.
With the computer-based assisted laboratory investigations giving us the iron profiles.
Yes.
Serum ferritin, iron binding capacity, and then transferrin, etc.
Yeah.
We find a situation in a generally healthy patient, in a completely healthy person, or a slightly comorbid conditions.
Yeah.
Hemoglobin value is accepted range of 12.5-13. Other values of the iron studies are low.
Yes.
Does these patients warrant an intravenous infusion of iron and correction of iron?
Yeah. If the question is, you can have an isolated iron deficiency as a mineral without a hemoglobin decline. This is well known. Time immemorial, you can have an isolated iron deficiency. The question is, very often in our day-to-day practice, isolated iron deficiency due to nutritional deficit appears to be uncommon. Very often it coexists with an underlying chronic disorder. Wherein your iron and TABC both will be low in anemia due to chronic infection. If it is isolated iron deficiency, the serum iron will be low, TIBC will be increased. The other clue from the laboratory will be ferritin. Serum ferritin will be low in isolated iron deficiency. If it is due to a chronic disorder, chronic infection, the renal disease, both iron and TIBC will be low and ferritin most often will be high. In addition, if you have a sophisticated lab, there's an investigative parameter, what's called as a soluble transferrin receptor assay, which is usually normal in iron deficiency and which is increased in anemia chronic disorder. But when you have both an iron deficiency in a patient who has a chronic infection, a not an uncommon clinical feature in our day-to-day medical world, a need for marrow to assess the marrow iron store, the particle, by first time may be needed in this situation. The IV ion, when the hemoglobin level is not low, the patient is otherwise not symptomatic due to iron deficiency, will not be warranted. And time again, we have been used to oral ion for so many years. And if I have to mention to you, what are the advantages of IV ion, which we are using it very often now? The worst situation, what I feel, is in obstetric situation, wherein you want a hemoglobin increase in the second or the third trimester, IV ion preparation is contraindicated in the first trimester pregnancy. You should be aware of that. We have got so many preparations now, starting from iron sucrose. Now we have gone to iron carboxy maltose, wherein you can use 1 gram at say 15 minutes to 20 minutes, you can get across 1 gram of IV ion, which is a great advantage, because orally it may take 2 to 3 months for you, but that cannot be misused, because the IV ion, 1 in 1,000, you may get into some adverse reaction. By and large, it is very safe in practice. I have used it for situations like ulcerative colitis, where the oral ion can aggravate the disease, or an elderly patient having a chronic atrophic gastritis, tons and tons of oral ion will not increase the hemoglobin. In this situation, the recourse to intravenous ion may be useful. Anemia in a patient in a nephrology unit undergoing dialysis with associated blood loss, IV ion is usually preferred, because already you have an access. And you should be aware, the erythropoietin that is used by nephrologists, it acts only when you have a sufficient ion in the bone marrow. This is an important thing. Otherwise, you will be wasting the cost of erythropoietin borne by the patient. Patient will be wasting. I'm sorry. We will not be.
Thank you.
I think I have answered. Thank you.
I request Dr. Varadharajan, our president, to come forward and hand over the certificate of appreciation to Professor Varadharajan.